The Lenovo Fab 2 Pro is the first smartphone that features Google Tango. Tango is Google's implementation of augmented reality. The Fab 2 Pro is designed to fully showcase what Tango can do and what future it brings. It's still a fully functional smartphone with a screen that might be a little too big for some. It has a full aluminium body and designed with chamfered edges for the extra shine. The glass display is raised a little, but it has a 2.5D edge that makes the corners feel very smooth. As the phone is too big, it's near impossible to reach the volume rockers one-handed without feeling the phone is about to slip off. As for the fingerprint sensor, I feel it's placed too low. A more natural placement is where the Tango camera is. I had to make a conscious effort to bend my finger a little to unlock the device. The speakers are not stereo speakers and can be easily muffled by covering the right speaker grill. The volume compensates for the lack of stereo with its loudness. The volume is quite loud at the maximum. I would have preferred front-facing speakers as it seems like such a big phone could have housed additional speakers.
And the headphone jack is also slightly misaligned. The antenna bands are closer to the edge on the standard model compared to the Pro model. On the back, the LED flash placement are also different. One on each side. For those planning to get a case,
to improve the sound quality, they have included a Dolby Atmos to enhance the entertainment experience by creating virtual 3D sound. It sounds the best with earphones and sounds like what you will hear at cinemas with Dolby surround sound. The bezels are very slim and does make the display pop up a little more. Due to the large footprint, I tend to grab the phone more securely. As a result, my fingers or palms tend to accidentally trigger the display. I felt that the placement of the main camera is too high. When taking photos, my fingers will obstruct the camera in landscape mode due to the way I hold the phone. Not a big deal, just have to make an effort to move my finger away. Hopefully, I wouldn't miss an important shot because of it. Overall, although it feels a little heavy, I like the whole look and feel to it. Personally, I prefer if the fingerprint sensor was a little higher. But there are definitely some design considerations that they made it this way. It's going to be a challenge to place this phone in regular pockets. Tough luck for those wearing tight pants. What's better than having a Quad HD resolution on a 6.4 inch screen? At 459 ppi, the display looks very sharp. The very thin bezels makes watching videos and playing games a very nice experience. Text and web pages are very clear and no pixelation can be seen. As for colors, they look pretty accurate and vibrant. There is the display effect settings where you can adjust the hue and color to your liking. It does lag or slow to respond when you are trying to toggle or when using the sliders. Viewing angles are great and still retain the clarity on the screen. It's good to know that the capacitive buttons are also backlit. The fingerprint sensor works perfectly with an unlock rate of almost 100%. The phone vibrates twice if it fails to authenticate and vibrates once if it's successful. The screen roughly takes 1 second to turn on when unlocking from the off-screen state. The sensor is always active, so it will work if the screen is off. Hardware-wise, the Lenovo Fab 2 Pro comes only in one configuration. 64GB of storage and 4GB of RAM. Out of the box, it has around 60GB of storage available for use, and it also supports microSD card up to 128GB. It's built into SIM card slot 2, and as this phone supports dual SIM, you have to choose between dual SIM or expandable storage. Talking about dual SIM, you can only choose either SIM card for data, calls, or messages at any one time. The other specs that complete the hardware are Bluetooth 4.0, Wi-Fi 802.11 A, B, G, N, AC, a built-in 4050mAh battery, 16MP back camera, 8MP front camera, depth and motion sensor, fisheye for tango, GPS, accelerometer, gyroscope, compass, and a notification LED. The Fab 2 Pro features mid-range specs with a Snapdragon 652 and Adreno 510. Booting up the phone takes about 55 seconds to the home screen. At 25 seconds, it prompts for the phone password if you have configured it. Running benchmarks seems laggy, but those are designed to push the limits of the phone. In actual world use, the graphics are quite smooth. When playing Modern Combat 5, Fractal Combat X, and Dead Effect 2, there was no sluggishness while gaming. The smooth frame rate, decent loading times, coupled with a large 2K screen, makes it even a better experience. The mid-range CPU should be able to take on most current demanding games, but the phone does get quite warm when gaming for long durations. Phone calls were stable with no drops at all, but the other party sounded a little soft at maximum volume. Reception was a constant 4-5 bars on both SIM cards, and 2-3 bars when underground or in the subway. As for UI, there were some small lags that was an eyesore. For example, opening the Tango app and pressing the home button, an obvious lag can be seen. Even for the app drawer, it blinks and takes a while to be shown. Hopefully in future updates, the UI can be fixed and optimized. As for multitasking, opening multiple apps poses no issues, as the 4GB of RAM on board should be able to handle heavy tasks. The Fab 2 Pro is running Android 6.0 with their Vibe UI 3.0 on top of it. There are some aesthetic changes compared to stock Android, but it's still quite similar. For those who take a lot of pictures and want to access the camera quickly, you can either press the power button twice or swipe the camera icon at the lock screen to quickly launch a camera. Daydream is much like a screensaver mode, when you can display pictures or a digital clock during charging or anytime you wish. Do not disturb mode is useful when asleep to prioritize which calls, messages, or reminder you will be alerted. You can customize the notifications for individual apps such as hiding sensitive content and so on. The Smart Assist menu contains features for ease of use on a big display. One-handed keypad that uses gyroscope to slide the smaller keypad left or right. I find this implementation a little weird and would have preferred it to be fixed and customizable. Floating shortcut creates a virtual button to access various features and apps. You can only choose which apps to be in a quick access and adjust the size and transparency of the virtual button. The rest of the features can't be changed. Other functions include double tap to wake, smart reduce, smart answer, and in-call noise cancellation. Individual app permissions can be set in the app menu if you want to control what apps can do. Security-wise, the smart lock keeps the phone unlocked, and how it determines that it's safe to remain that way is by on-body detection, trusted place, trusted devices, and trusted voice. Google Tango is the main feature of this phone, and it uses an array of sensors to bring Tango alive. At the back, you have the back-facing camera, a depth sensor, a motion tracking sensor, and a fisheye camera for Tango. They work together to detect position relative to the surrounding without the use of GPS. With this, developers can create cool apps that take advantage of this technology. Many apps like Hot Wheels, Holo, or tools like Measure can be found on the Play Store showcasing the different uses of Tango. It's fun to play with, but personally, it's currently not a must-have feature on a phone. I don't see myself using it on a daily basis, except maybe to have fun and showing it to others. Maybe in future, when there are more apps for Tango, like virtual shopping and such, we can see it being more mainstream. The 4050mAh battery isn't big if you consider the large footprint of the phone. Battery life was quite okay considering my usage, but I felt it could have been better. Usually, I unplug my phone at around 7:30am with lots of web surfing, messaging, different apps for online shopping, YouTube, and some gaming. By around 9-10pm before I plugged the phone into the charger, I had about 5-10% battery life left. The 2K screen could have drained more battery than a 1080p display, but it looks great on such a big phone. Nonetheless, it should last throughout the day under normal use. If you are using Tango on a daily basis, it drains battery very quickly and tends to heat up. Just messing around with Tango drains the battery by 15% in 30 minutes. Be sure to have a charger ready if you intend to use Tango a lot. Talking about charging, it supports turbo charge. It took around 1.5 hours to get from 0 to 100%. There is also the battery saver mode that reduces the device performance to extend battery life. Photos taken was above average, but not the best. Images taken in the day are quite clear, but photos are easily blurred with a slight movement. I found it difficult to keep very still to take a nice shot. The quality of night shots are quite disappointing. It's grainy and noisy. It's also easily blurred with a slight movement of the phone. I also noticed that the focus changes to the center location after a photo is taken. It doesn't stay focused on the previous object. The HDR mode makes photos a lot brighter in both day and night setting, but it takes a little longer to process. As for night mode, it also makes the photo look a lot brighter, but not as bright as HDR mode. Autofocus was quite quick, but sometimes it fails to focus on the object in front. Likewise for tapping focus, the camera also fails to focus on the tap object. There is no OIS on this phone and videos will definitely be shaky. The camera can only record in 720p and 1080p.
Hey guys, this is Richard here. I don't think you can get much from this camera, but I think it performs fine as a selfie camera.
The Lenovo Fab 2 Pro is a good device. The large 6.4-inch Quad HD screen is great for media consumption, and the build quality is that of a high-end device. On the other hand, the UI isn't quite optimized, and the camera is just average. It cost me SGD 630 for this mid-range hardware device. Seems like the majority of the cost goes into featuring Tango. It's great to feature Tango and see how it works, and see what possibilities it might bring. Do I see myself using this phone? Currently, no. It seems like it's in the trial stage and there are issues that need to be fixed. This phone is definitely not for everyone, and hopefully in future versions, issues can be ironed out, and much more features to showcase. If you don't mind the price or size, it's great to build Google Tango apps with, and also those who want to experience augmented reality. That's all for this video, I hope you enjoyed it, and if you did, feel free to leave a like and subscribe to see more of such content. If you have any questions, feel free to leave in the comments below. Thanks for watching and see you guys in the next one.